I'm going to talk about the investment in detail. But I have two main things. I'm going to talk about the irreducibility and singularity of a point of view like this, monetized in a projective space as a projective curve. So I'm not going to talk about my chance criteria or whatever, but I'm talking about, like, say, cost center and polytope. And I define sort of this concept of using polytope as given a variable or a function into variables, you plot the points ij corresponding to the degrees of x and y respectively on the xy plane, you look at the results in common solve. And here a common solve of x is the smallest common set that contains plus. That's an example right here. And you sort of see that a unique new polytope can be assigned to each given function. And how this relates to absolute reducibility of the polynomial connects to this proposition, where if f factors, then the shape new polytope of f decomposes into small polytopes via Minkowski sum, which I guess is a fancy way of summing up the sets element-wise. So here, in this case, if this is the case, we call the pf decomposable. So i.e., if you take the contrapositive of this proposition, if the shape is decomposable, then f is absolutely reducible, i.e., reducible over unbreakable. Here's an example to solidify our understanding of a new polytope and summation beyond the Minkowski sum. That shape on the left is a triangle plus a square. And I guess the way you think about each point is you think about points as vectors. So you sort of add 0, plus 0, 0, and so on. So because this is the case, you can find a field here F2 in which F factors, whereas F is irreducible Q. So my attempt was on what's called the Bertini reducibility theorem for finding fields. So basically what this is saying is if you take a random homogeneous 3D polynomial in Pn Fq with n greater than 1, that random polynomial is going to be irreducible with probability 1. And my sort of combinatorial analogy was to see if a randomly chosen shape, not the random polynomial, is indecomposable. So what I did was I chose a random set of points in the triangular region bounded by 0, 0, t0, and 0, b. It had to be triangular because when you homogenize the polynomial into variables, you get a homogeneous 3D polynomial in three variables. Well, here and randomly choose each point probability q minus 1 over q so that each monomial of that polynomial has a non-zero coefficient in f2. So I have this data, but it basically sort of shows that for both cases, I guess if you fix d, increase q, or fix q, increase d, you get less and less indecomposable polytopes. So I found it's actually quite hard to get a random polytope that is indecomposable. So I guess the theorem is not true in this particular analogy. I guess it makes sense because the polytope being indecomposable is actually stronger than the polynomial being just irreducible in that field. And I wanted to continue this idea of polytopes with new diagram in general. So we can now switch gears to the second part, which I was looking at, which is the singularity on a polynomial on a curve. So now the implicit condition I'm going to sort of apply would be, how is a degree homogeneous irreducible curve, f, x, y, z, at a singular point at p equals 0, 0, 1. Singular means blah, blah, blah. And it makes sense, because this is the case, to look at the affine curve of the projective one. And here I'm going to define a bunch of numbers whose definitions don't really matter for this purpose, but the Milner number is defined by this dimension of some same with the delta invariant, the dimension of some quotient space. But I guess the more interesting part is the branching number. So branching number is the number of points that P, which is a particular point on that curve, just one point, that splits into the curve's non-singular model, i.e. resolution. And what that means is that there exists a finite sort of sequence of maps called blow-ups that can desingularize a singular point. So we start with a singular curve and apply this finite sequence of maps and get to a smooth curve that is sort of equivalent to the singular curve in some sense. And the branching number is the number of points that that singularity splits into. So the main point is these are not just easy to compute just from the definitions. And they happen to satisfy this formula of the Hilbert formula. And I was looking at something similar to polysum, but I was using a new definition of the shape called Newton polygon. And also note that this is sort of different from the traditional notion of Newton polygon, but in the sense I want to see, like I find the polygon as the lower complex hall of the Newton polygon union, sort of the intersection of the XY axis. So here, the blue region of the Newton polygon, I was looking at the NF, the Newton polygon, is the yellow region, and half the upper boundary, the red line. And I can define these numbers that are only dependent on Newton polygons. And here, mu, I can define mu as 1 minus V1 plus 2 times V2, where V1 is essentially the part of the length of the part of the XY axis that intersects with the polygon. And R, I guess V2 is the area of the polygon. R is the number of lattice points on n at minus 1, delta, more lattice points. And they happen to satisfy this quasi-Euler formula by the distance x theorem. So there's this lemma that the branching number R is equal to the number of distinct irreducible factors of f in the ring of power series, which sort of gives insight into the crux, which is that when f is not degenerate, a notion of which I'm not going to go into detail at the moment, but in which in fact all generic curves are, these hold true. So now we have an easy way to compute the Hilbert number, the branching number, and the delta invariant, respectively. So here we have an example. And just using the polygon, right, the yellow region, you can compute these numbers. And using sort of the plot on the real plane as a reference, which should always rely on because R is not in a very close field. We sort of see that we have a node at the origin as a singularity, and the R being 2, the branching number being 2 makes sense because one of the properties of the node is that when it's desingularized, it sort of splits into distinct points. That we see also with what's called the typical nodal curve example, right? R equals 2. With the cusp, it's kind of different because at the origin, the point is not split, so that R equals 2. So that's some more cool examples. I guess the attack node, the branching number is 2, the grand void cusp, which I also found kind of interesting because R equals 1, it's a cusp. And rows with 3 petals. And the last one looks surprisingly smooth, yet the singular point becomes 3 distinct points. And back to the Poito, we can talk about one more thing, which is the genus. And if I define this arbitrary number called g as the number of interior lattice points for the new Poito, and also the same sort of notion applies, if the f is non-degenerate, which in fact all geometric points are, we get this fact that is counting the lattice points, the interior lattice points. You get the geometric genus of the curve. And also there's the other type of genus called the arithmetic genus, which stays as d minus 1 shifts 2, where d is the degree of the curve. But I guess this is a connection I found with the input to a polygon satisfying this genus degree formula, where there's the geometric genus, where they agree if the curve is smooth. But if the curve is not smooth, the geometric genus decreases. So in this case, just counting the points in the blue region, G equals 0 in both cases. Here we have a genus 2 curve, where if you draw the same thing, you have two interior lines. So easy computation by hand is made possible. So my initial motivation is actually from algebraic geometric coding theory, and you can come up with an NKT error corrected code, whatever that is, polynomial code. And the point is we always want to maximize the code rate, which translates into minimizing the ratio of g, or the number of points on that curve of FQ. So currently it's an open problem to minimize this ratio of g genus over the number of points on that curve, FQ. And if you find a good curve with less genus, but lots of points, you can actually submit it to many points on the board and get your name referenced. So huge thank you to Dan and Carl. And now Michael's going to talk about something else.
This is agree with the negative counter argument on too far. On the other hand, in the polynomial case, you have 1 over k, around 1 over k cubed by k, you reduce the polynomials of degree k. And you take that to the c sub k, because you have that many choices. Then you overcount, because you're counting like 1, 2, 3, 4, all the permutations of that. So you divide by c sub k factorial. And this is a polynomial of q of degree n, and the leading coefficient is precisely this. So this shows a connection between if you take q fixed and you look over all the polynomials, this gives a pretty good connection here. And it's not clear why this connection might exist, because if you think about it, the multiplication structure is very different. Because for polynomials, it's non-invertible and it's abelian. But on the other hand, the symmetric group is invertible, it forms a group, and it is abelian. It's very non-abelian. And the actual connection here is pretty interesting, but I don't have time to talk about it. But if you're interested, then feel free to talk to me about it after. So moving on, now the question is, what if you take a fixed polynomial f and you consider it in different fields q? And the theorem by Frobenius actually has a good connection here. So the theorem by Frobenius says that if you take a polynomial f, an integer coefficient in polynomial f, and you reduce it mod p, meaning that you pretend that it's a polynomial in f, then depending on what prime you choose, you still have a different splitting type. And it turns out that the proportion of primes, given a specific splitting type, converges to the proportion of automorphisms in a Galois group of the splitting field, which have the corresponding selective type. And by that, I mean you identify an automorphism in the Galois group with its it induces a permutation on the roots of F. And that has a second type. And in particular, so you identify basically that as an element of the symmetric group. So motivated by this, the general question that my researcher was asking was, if you take a two-variable polynomial, integer polynomial in Z, X, Y, and now, instead of just reducing it mod p, you reduce it mod fq. So you take it in fq. And then furthermore, you substitute elements of fq for y. So basically make it a one variable polynomial. And then you look at the distribution of splitting types under this fixed f. And so this was a really hard problem to tackle all at once. So to motivate a special case, I was motivated by a special case of the Frobenius theorem, which actually helps you prove the quantitative version of Dirichlet's theorem on arithmetic progressions. So what that is given an integer n, for every a cocon to n, the proportion of primes that are equivalent to a mod m is 1 over the order 500 to m. So basically saying that over all residue classes mod m, the distribution of primes are the same. So to prove this, you can prove special cases of this using the theorem by Frobenius by taking f of x equaling to x to the n minus 1. So in this case, the Galois group as an extension of q is going to be Gal q with a root of q joined to it over q. So recall that the automorphisms here are defined by mapping one root of unity to another root of unity to the eighth power, where a is cocon to f. And this has a certain cycle type that appears a lot, and the cycle type of this, we'll just call it CYC of sigma sub A. So on the other hand, if you take this polynomial and increase it mod p, so we know the roots are the form 1 zeta squared dot 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 zeta omega at times 1. And so we know that if we take this in FP, we know the Yau algorithm in FP is going to be Yau FPTM, so just some extension. And in particular, this is generated by the Frobenius map, X mapping to XP. And so, in particular, this produces the roots and defines the permutation zeta mapping to zeta P. And it can be shown that the cycle type of this permutation is precisely the same thing as the splitting type of this polynomial mod P. And so it turns out from this it's clear to see that the splitting type only depends on the residue class of P, P mod N. So for example, if N is equal to 12, the residue classes, the co-prime residue classes are 1, 5, 7, 11. And the splitting types here are going to be precisely the cycle type here of these automorphic zones. So by the theorem, each of these classes are equally distributed because the cycles here in Yau are pretty equally distributed. So this was the motivation for the specific question I was asking, which looks at the polynomial, the two-variable polynomial x to the n minus y. And so in particular, this is a generalized Ricci-Fermi basically, because what we're doing is we're taking it in a field, let's say FQ, and then substituting specific elements of the field, K, for Y. So basically we're looking at splitting types of X to the N minus K over certain finite field orders. And so I'll just go over one special case of the research because it's kind of hard to, it's like there's a lot of technicalities. So if K is an N power in FQ, that there's some element in FQ that whose n power is k, then we know that this polynomial has at least one solution in FQ. And also we know that the other solutions are just going to be this solution times the community. So recall that the Frobenius map, x mapping to x to the q, is a automorphism, so it permutes these roots. And in particular, since it's in the Yau algorithm, it must fix fq. So it sends alpha to the q to alpha. So we know that. We know that's true. And the rest of the permutation is therefore defined the same, where you have alpha theta to the I mapping to alpha theta to the qi. And in particular, this is the same as we saw before. It's a cycle type of sigma q. So here you can see a clear connection between the Frobenius theorem. It's actually a generalization because now it works for prime powers. And also it works no matter what k you put in. Because in the Frobenius case, you're only putting in k equals 1.
Thank you all. I hope you've had a nice summer. Looking at your